With us now is the attorney for the Brown family, Benjamin Crump, and civil rights lawyer Charles Coleman here in the studio. Mr. Crump, thank you for joining us. I want to start with you. I want to ask, I'm sure you're probably not surprised that Officer Darren Wilson, or former Officer Darren Wilson, now has resigned from the Ferguson police force.
Well, that was not unexpected news. We had expected the police officer would do what was in his best interest, both professionally and personally, and we did not think he would be very effective continuing as a law enforcement officer with the Ferguson Police Department, neither effective in the community or with the police department. And so, but what our clients are still trying to deal with is the fact that the comments that he has a clear conscience, he would have did everything exactly like he did it, because it's troubling to them. Their unarmed son killed in this manner, and the shooter saying, I have a clear conscience, I don't have a problem with it. They would have expected more remorse. Even if he felt he had to do something to save his life, you still say, what kind of person isn't bothered by it, says, I have a clear conscience? They question, did he have a conscience at all?
We are pleased to welcome the Honorable David Patterson, the former governor of New York, and civil rights attorney John Burns. Also, we have from San Francisco, Jack Hart, a police lieutenant connected with the police academy there. And welcome to all of you gentlemen. Thank you so much for being here, a part of this town hall. Governor, I want to start with you, if I may. What's your opinion about the way the governor of Missouri, Jay Nixon, as well as the officials in St. Louis County and even in Ferguson have handled these mainly what started off to be peaceful gatherings that quickly seemed to degenerate, if you will, because of, it would seem, a police presence, a militarized police presence?
I think the first thing I would have done if I was the governor would have been to have brought in a special prosecutor and not let a prosecutor who was in that area, who had a relationship with many people involved in this case, actually prosecute that case. What you've got to do to try to create peace is take action that makes everyone feel as if the system can actually help them.
From Chicago, a veteran of this country's long struggle for civil rights, and of course, the founder of the Rainbow Push Coalition, People United to Save Humanity. Reverend, welcome. And, you know, you've been in Ferguson many times over the past months. I've got to ask, first and foremost, your reaction to the grand jury decision.
Well, the grand jury concluded that the policeman shooting at him 12 times, hitting him 6 to 8 times, was justifiable. We think not. At best, you shoot to apprehend, he shot to kill, and the jury let him walk away. And that was a great grievance. And since it's a national pattern, it compounds the pain.
We see and have witnessed again a non-indictment and travesty of justice in many people's eyes. How does this make you feel? Do you feel this is a great setback for what you are trying to do to right the wrongs?
I definitely feel that it's a setback to what we're trying to do because it just shows that the value of African-American young men and women lives are as equal value. We don't get the same justice when it comes to other ethnicity groups slaying our children in the streets.
Welcome back. From the first tweet showing Michael Brown's body on the street to sophisticated video projects on YouTube, social media is a big part of the story in Ferguson, Missouri. So is a 24-hour, never-ending news cycle. The prosecutor blamed the cable frenzy for fanning the flames of protest.
Chris Phillips is a video journalist whose 100 Days, 100 Seconds video is making waves, and he joins us from St. Louis. And here in the studio, we have Dante Berry, deputy director for the Million Hoodies Group, which uses social media to organize demonstrations, as well as Dr. Paul Levinson, who is a professor of media studies at Fordham University. Welcome to all of you gentlemen. Thank you so much for being here. Dr. Levinson, let's start with you. We'll go at the academic approach first, and that is talk about how the pervasiveness of social media. Social media has been around for a while, but it's ubiquitous now. How it has changed what's happening in Ferguson?
Social media have given people a voice. Now, even on a wonderful network such as Arise, most people can't express themselves. Only a minute portion of the population can get onto Arise TV. In contrast to that, anyone can tweet, anyone can put up a video on YouTube, anyone can speak out on Facebook and Tumblr and all the others. And that's one of the best things that's happened to our democratic process. And you see it working at its best when you have tragic situations like this, which require the public's continued attention.